nice when a laptop closes?
We're at my house right now. Today's Dylan's birthday, and we're doing an event that we did about 2 years ago, and we're kind of winging it as far as where we're going and how organized the whole event is, but we're gonna skate from the top of Manhattan to the bottom of Manhattan to the bench where he did the impossible. I thought it would just be like a cool event to get people involved. We did the event in LA last times, but I feel like here he just had a pretty big presence here, and I feel like it would suck to not share that with people. So yeah, we're doing that today with Dylan's sister. She'll be running, which is cool.
Oh, cool. People showed up. Are you here for this thing?
Yeah.
Thanks for showing up.
Yeah,
appreciate it.
Yeah, yeah, man.
Thanks for showing up. How's it going?
Good.
You good?
Today I'm going to be running. Hopefully the whole thing. We'll see. The Dylan Reeder Foundation. All proceeds go to City of Hope to help raise awareness for leukemia. So.
Kind of the halfway point, Duke Ellington Circle, at the top of Central Park, northeast corner.
We're at the finish line. We're at the infamous Dylan bench, that impossible that changed the world for a lot of people. Kind of felt like it was a significant spot to meet up. Ends up being at the bottom of Manhattan, and it just made sense. But yeah, it's really special. All these people came out, went the distance, they're having beers, people are smiling, taking photos, and saying nice things. It's more than we could ask for.
Right up there. Yeah, it's on.
We're in Nashville. We were recording for the last 5 days on the other side of town. So we're gonna finish the record here. We have 2 more days recording. I'm kind of sprinkling the last little bits for this new record, which would be my 3rd record. I moved to New York in October. I kind of saw it as a good opportunity to write an album. Having the apartment, not being able to go outside as much, I was able to kind of put my head down and write this whole record. There is a sound, but I don't know. I don't know where I get my personal sound from. I think I get my sound from like my limitations as a musician. So like what I can do at home is what gets applied to anything that I do at the studio with musicians that can translate it in a different way. It's made me want to learn more and actually understand. They're speaking a completely different language here. You know, these people that know so much about gear and so much about the instruments and sounds and microphone placement, stuff you don't really learn. I don't know. It's really inspiring. This is the part. For me, they say the other stuff takes longer, but for me, this is the stuff that takes me a bit longer. It's like, what is like the room that I'm trying to design? Like if you're listening to a song, what do you want it to feel like? So that's more or less what we're doing.
Yeah, we're done. We just finished a record. Yeah, 6 days. Out in August.
What happens next?
Comes out for the people to hear.
Yeah.
We say lips.
What do you say?
Is that a wrap?
That's our, this is our biggest fan right here, my biggest fan.
Yeah, bud.
I'll get one listen. Yeah, that'll be a fraction of a penny on Spotify. Yeah. opera. It's a weird suburban town, probably 20, 25 minutes outside of LA.
Yeah, I got fenced a lot too, at recess. I was a pretty bad kid.
What's fenced?
Where you had to sit on the fence and watch kids play during recess, yeah.
So one time, when I was like in fifth grade, the local newspaper, they were able to get me out of lunch break and got me to shoot a photo ollieing over this curb over this little drop right here. Still got it. There goes the bearings.
Probably said something like, getting fucked up tonight. And that's when my career started. I think that's when I knew I was actually gonna like skate for a living, probably. Not for a living, but try to give it a good crack.
Ready? Get the angle. This is the Menacomati angle. French Fred. It's actually how they filmed it. That was the one where the five stair and then Arto did the nose blunt. Switch flip, turned around, nose blunt. There we go. Yeah, it wasn't that tall, but that's the termite roof right there. I mean, it's not the same roof, but this is exactly where the roof was, where I did the termite cover. Termite was a little kid company. I don't know, as soon as you're a teenager or something, you get kicked off. I don't really remember, but I think I was like 9 or 10 when I did it, but I ollied off the roof right here.
Stoked?
Oh yeah. I didn't think I was gonna get the cut. I had no clue. But yeah, backwards hat, pretty cool. Spiked hair, also pretty cool. You can't see it there.
Hey, this is Austyn Gillette, kicking the work. We're gonna teach you how to do kickflip today.
I don't know, like any suburban town or anybody's hometown, there's no, you know, you kind of hit the ceiling pretty quickly, or if you don't, you kind of turn into everybody else. And I feel like skateboarding for me was the vehicle and my way of getting out of this area and kind of like at least experiencing the rest of the world. I don't know if I was gonna do that otherwise. That was the first place that I moved, was SF. I was going there a lot when I was like 14. Yeah, it was obviously more exciting than this. There's a building that's over like 12 feet tall here. I was skating there a lot with Brennan, Conroy, and then the Habitat guys. And they were all living there at the time. Stefan was living in Sacramento. Brennan was living in SF. Raymond Molinar was living in SF at the time as well. So it kind of just made sense. That's kind of where I needed to be. I just go to different coffee shops and read and look for spots. I was just, you know, skate. I just had skate brain. That was Origin Days, yep. 17, 18. I think that was the part where I started doing NBDs. I don't know if that exists anymore, but that was, yeah.
What's an NBD for you in that one?
A lot of tricks.
Yeah?
Back 180-50 that I stole from Jake Johnson. I saw him trying it. I think he was trying to 180-50. Now everybody does it on handrails. Ollie backs a 180-50, shove it in the middle. That's never been done. Half cab 50 backside flip. I hadn't seen that at the time. This is the high school that I went to for senior year. But this is the bump to ledge. It's actually pretty good. Or maybe not, it's really tall. I should come back to it. I did independent studies for 9th and 10th grade, skipped 11th grade. And then went to Habitat, made me go back to high school because they wanted me to have that experience of just being a, you know, normal kid and going to the school dances, falling in love.
How come?
I think because I was just traveling at such a young age and like going on trips and kind of experiencing like these other guys' lives without even having like a childhood that like I could remember, and they wanted me to have that experience. I was really grateful for it, but. I wonder if he's working. Former, check it out. Look at us go. We're a company. Look at Jake. And we got some window real estate in La Habra, hometown. I didn't even know about that.
How's that feel? Is that cool?
We made it. We did it. How's that? That feels cool.
How are we, sir?
Hi, baby.
How you doing?
Excellent. Yeah? Yeah. Shop line?
Dude, this is huge.
Get it in.
Walter board. Damn, I don't even have one of those.
A little 3D?
Yeah?
Whoa. Can I gift you it?
No, you don't have to do that.
Please, if you don't have one.
Really?
Yes.
Maybe put it on hold. Are you serious?
It's Walt. It's your boy.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
What was 3D?
It was Brian's BA's brainchild. He like hit me up at a Tampa and Staba was there, and then he was talking about starting a new board company, and then at that time, yeah, I was ready for change, but yeah, and then I had knee surgeries right as the company kind of got off the ground, and then I couldn't really skate, so nothing happened. Yeah, I don't know what Brian was doing at the time too. Habitat, 3D, Weekend, a brand that didn't happen, and then yeah, Habitat.
What made you pull the
trigger? Now I'm back on 3D. We were all just friends. Grant was living with me as well, but it was after I had my surgeries, and I was already hanging out with everybody, and the deal was, when I was talking to him, was, can we skate every day? Can we work on a video project? I just need people to skate with. And he's like, yeah, we're already doing it. Why don't we just make it easy and continue what we're doing? And I don't know. I think it helped out a lot because we were living together as well. We got a lot done. It was just a bunch of friends doing their thing. It's exactly what it looks like right now, what Weekend's doing. So that's kind of what it felt like. It was just a time and a place, and everything kind of like just happened very naturally. I felt a little bit weird for a second, and I didn't really want that. I just wanted to be friends. And then at that time, Dill hit me up and wanted to start a company with FA and hockey. And then he was like, I want you to start writing our boards and we'll figure out when we're gonna start this company. And 6 months later, he hit me up and he was just saying that he was a little, he was super busy with doing graphics with FA and hockey. And fair enough, I understand it, just doing my own brand as well. So there were no hard feelings there. It was more of just like, kind of got left hanging high and dry on that one, but things worked out, and things worked out for him, things worked out for me, so I think those things happen for a reason. I think with that part, with Reading Gear, I was trying to, it was just for my brand, for a former, so it was trying to like validate the brand that like we're not just like a lifestyle brand or a skate and surf brand. It was like I wanted people to take the, not even myself seriously, but the brand. It was more about that and trying to push it. And I think it helped out a lot. I was very, very unsponsored for a little bit. probably a year and a half, 2 years after Huff, they canned the shoe program. I didn't have a board sponsor, didn't have a shoe sponsor.
What did it feel like to be a pro skater without?
I wasn't a pro skater. I was Flo for a while.
Yeah.
I was pretty happy with where I was at with just kind of being behind the scenes and working on the clothing company. And that, you know, eventually drove me nuts. But I kind of like realized like, oh shit, I'm turning into office body. Like things were kind of shifting, and then the Globe thing came about. And I was like, I don't know what this would look like. I'd need to have quite a bit of control with that and kind of be excited about it and start a new program. And then Habitat as well, it kind of like all happened at the same time. And I think it was maybe the world's way of just telling me that I needed to like experience what it would be like to work a regular job. Mm. And I'm very grateful for that time.
Make it happen.
Making it happen. We're a company. There's no going back now. That was an ego check, not being sponsored. That'll do it. When you're not getting validation, nobody's knocking on the door, but you're still like
kind of at the peak of your, I hate saying career, but whatever. It's a weird feeling. It's pretty discouraging. But I think even just like, after going through an injury, it does the same thing. Helps you reevaluate your identity and your place in life. And I think that's super important for personal growth. And I don't think that skateboarders really, there is so much downtime, but that's the last thing that they're gonna be working on. In a lot of industries or other people, like, it's almost required that do therapy and meditate and do all these other things that can get you through like this mundane life that a lot of people lead. But yeah, we're extremely fortunate. What do I think what people think of me?
Yeah, the public.
I don't know. It's hard with the internet. Probably people, I try to stay off of it as much as possible so they don't have to think about that.
This is like a 411 spot.
People, I'd like to just inspire people to like do shit that makes them feel uncomfortable.
Uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Why is that?
Why?
Yeah.
That's where personal growth develops. That's where you'll start to develop your own personality, and you'll stop copying people. And that's what everybody's doing right now, is copying each other. It's very few that stick out. And I feel like hopefully I do that for people. I'm definitely, it took a while to find that. You know,
7 minutes till therapy. That's good stuff.
I feel like that's like just now happening.
Yeah.
31. Kind of, yeah. I'm like really comfortable with the choices that I make and what I'm doing with my career, or how I'm designing things, or my outlook on life. I feel like I finally figured that out. And that took a long time.
Is that
ancient?
Yes, yeah.